Wow, everybody quieted down. I didn't even have to ask them. Hello, good afternoon. On behalf of the Department of Epidemiology, I'd like to welcome you to the third Harry Guest Memorial Lecture. I'm Andy Olshan, Chair of the Department of Epidemiology, and first like to give a few thanks. First like to thank Till and the UNC ISPE student chapter, co-chairs Jenny Lund and Brad Wheeler for organizing this event. Would also like to thank all of you for attending, including our special guests from Merck and GSK, and especially Jerry Guest for being here today with us. Would also like to note the all-important reception that we have after this event outside the lobby, just outside the main entrance of the Department of Epidemiology. I'd like to just say just a few words about this event, the third annual Harry Guest Memorial Lecture, and really is just, I think it really is one of my favorite and become really a special event, not just for the Pharmacoepi program, but also for the department. And that's for several reasons, and of course relates to largely to Harry. He was so influential and important to the field of pharmacoepidemiology, to Merck, where he worked many years, but also to the department as a whole. He was the visionary architect and engineer for our departmental pharmacoepidemiology program. He laid the foundation for the program, which I really do believe is internationally recognized for its world-class research and training program. And seeing our students here today also reminds me of his legacy in establishing a training program that's produced and continuing to produce a critical mass of outstanding students, which in I've come to learn a lot about pharmacoepidemiology in the last couple of years, is really critical to train the next generation of leaders in pharmacoepidemiology. And I'm really proud of our program and proud of our students for being the leaders of the field. And again, that is so much and is attributable to Harry. And he really left us with the strong collaborations we have with Merck, GSK, a number of other organizations and individuals. And these threads have undoubtedly allowed the UNC program to not only maintain its momentum, its prominence, but really to now flourish after his passing. And so really today's event provides this annual opportunity to take stock of how far we've come as a program and Harry's many contributions to that. And we really have this opportunity for us to sort of give pause and thanks to Harry for establishing these many strong points of the pharmacoepidemiology program, and of course that reflects very well on the department and the School of Public Health and the university. So I will pass on the lead role here to Jenny Lund, who will introduce today's distinguished speaker, Stephen Evans. Thank you.
Okay, so thank you for joining us today for the third annual Harry Guest Memorial Lecture. As Andy said, I'm Jenny Lund. I'm a third-year doctoral student and also one of the co-chairs, along with Brad Wheeler, of the ISPE UNC student chapter. And since 2008, our chapter has sponsored the Harry Guest Memorial Lecture. And this series was really conceived of by students to honor Harry Guest, the creator of the Pharmacoepi program, and also to remember his outstanding dedication to teaching and mentoring. And because many of the students that are new to UNC, including myself, didn't have the occasion actually to work or actually get to know Harry, this has become a really important point of reflection to really acknowledge and to honor his contribution as the founder and the father of pharmacoepidemiology at UNC. And I'm really proud to be a part of this new tradition. So it's my distinct pleasure to introduce to you Stephen Evans, professor of pharmacoepidemiology from the London School of Hygiene and Tropical Medicine, who is here with us today to deliver the Harry Guest Lecture. Professor Evans received his first degree in physics in the UK in 1966, including a year of study in the US here at Swarthmore College in Pennsylvania. After graduating, he was a scientific programmer at CERN, the European Organization for Nuclear Research in Geneva, where he actually focused on data analysis and pattern recognition for physics experiments with Professor Rubbia, who is a Nobel laureate. After working in physics and computing, he did his master's in medical statistics at the London School of Tropical Medicine and Hygiene, again. And he has been a professor there of pharmacoepidemiology in the Department of Epidemiology and Population Health since 2002. From 1995 through 1999, Professor Evans was the head of epidemiology at the United Kingdom Medicines Control Agency, which is really the UK counterpart to the FDA. And in 2001, Stephen Evans became the only non-physician fellow of the Royal College of Physicians of Edinburgh, a huge honor. So Professor Evans has an impressive list of publications where he's authored or co-authored over 200 medical research manuscripts. And most of these are in pharmacoepidemiology or clinical trials. But some of them actually have a lot of relevance to his talk today, which focus on peer review and detecting research fraud. Stephen has been actively involved in the International Society for Pharmacoepidemiology and is currently the president-elect of the group, and which is one of the reasons why we invited him here today to speak. Professor Evans has a deep insight into the challenges that pharmacoepidemiology faces and also is an excellent and engaging speaker, as I'm sure you'll soon see. So please join me in warmly welcoming Stephen Evans.
Thank you very much. Jenny, thank you very much for that introduction. I don't really recognize the person you introduced, but we'll live with that. Thank you very much. I want to obviously give thanks to UNC and the student chapter, especially Jenny, for inviting me. I think I have enormous sympathy for her and the others who've invited me, because when at the end of the lecture they all come and say, "Why did you invite that jerk here?" You should really have sympathy for them and for Till and so on and the others there. I also want to obviously give thanks to the late Harry Guess, who was such an inspiration. At Nashville, at the annual conference of ISPE in 2005, I sat with Harry, just the two of us, at a meal in the evening. The two of us sat there, and we enjoyed a meal, and Harry said to me, "I'm dying." And that's a kind of conversation stopper in a way, isn't it? But people who know me say it would be very difficult to stop me talking, but the pleasure I had in chatting with Harry, who was accepting of the fact that he hadn't got long to live, and the gentle way with which he addressed issues was such an inspiration. And I feel enormously privileged to have had that particular time with him. I'd met him some time before on the other side of the table, as you might say, when I was at the UK Medicines Control Agency, and we had hauled Merck before us over some issue. The other thing I want to do is acknowledge Henry Cloud, who's written a book called Integrity, published by HarperCollins in 2006, and I think that's a great book. Now, I'm going to give you some declarations of interest, and at the end of these, some of you will probably already be offended and will say he's the jerk, but I don't need to go through all of those things. I'm involved with WHO and the European Medicines Agency. I am not personally funded by pharmaceutical companies because of my regulatory involvement, but I am on the scientific advisory board of II4SM, and I've had fees from OMOP for reviewing things. I was a statistical advisor and hanger at the British Medical Journal for a lot of years on the hanging committee. And all the authors would think that you were a terrible person because you were on the hanging committee. But it was named after the Royal Academy's hanging committee, which decides which paintings are to be hung in the summer exhibition. And to be hung at the BMJ is a considerable honor. right? It means you've got as far as getting before the editorial committee. And there is a famous painting of the hanging committee of the Royal Academy deciding on the paintings then. And people would come in and hold a painting up and they'd say, hang or don't hang. So to be hung was good. But of course, the authors would all think that you were hanging meant that they had their view of their papers that you were doing this to them. But one of the things at the BMJ we said was that conflicts of interest and declarations of interest should express strong opinions. And not just financial things, because those can often be hidden and you might be embarrassed if you learn about them. And I want to say that I'm a disciple of Jesus. I don't want to use the word Christian because that has lots of very often unwanted connotations. And in particular, the way that Christians have treated Jews, among others, has been just dreadful in my view. So I want to call myself a disciple of Jesus. And that means that when I look at integrity, I come with a particular worldview, in a sense, and I'm prepared to say that here. I don't know that you've probably ever heard anyone offer that as a conflict of interest before. Anyway, so here's the outline, and that's what I'm going to try and talk about. Integrity and areas of the research process. And I'm not going to tell you anything terribly new, and the students here will probably all have fallen asleep before too long. Did you not get any of my things here? You know, I had a lecturer who came to my lectures, all of my lectures over a 2-year period. And at the end of one of my lectures, he had 5 pages of notes from my lecture. And these were notes of the things I'd done wrong in my lectures. And after every lecture, he told me all the things I'd done wrong. And one of the key things was that when we had an overhead projector, and I would write on the overhead projector, one of the things was, he'd said to me, look at the screen, because it's often out of focus. And that must have been 30 years ago, and I haven't learned a thing. It's appalling, isn't it? I'm very sorry. Anyway, I'd very carefully not had gone through with this list such that they only came in one at a time. So the bit about disciple of Jesus was on there. Right, there's the outline, and I won't go through the details. What's integrity? Firm adherence to a code of especially moral or artistic value, it suggested. An unimpaired condition, and of course for the medics here, medical integrity says that you are actually kind of functioning okay. And the quality or state of being complete or undivided. And in some senses, divisions are opposite to integrity. And it's obviously an integer in mathematics, a whole number. There is an ethical concept there, and modern usage often tries to avoid moralistic terms. But I want to talk about it as wholeness, not just in maths. And from that point of view, honesty is not the entirety. We talk about data integrity, and the ISPE mid-year meeting on Monday, session 3, has data integrity in the title. And we talk about that we don't want the data corrupted. And it's a very interesting usage there. There's an alternative Harvard view. Now, down here, of course, you've been sucking the best of Harvard people out of Harvard. And, you know, Harvard views aren't necessarily the best there are. I can offend everybody. All right, don't worry. And they think that it has nothing to do with good versus bad, right versus wrong behavior. And I'd like to disagree with that, really. I think integrity means being a whole person, and it means being a whole person in a good way. And they talk about it as honoring your word. And one of the things in relation to being a disciple of Jesus, I think, if you see what he teaches, he says that lots of us, in fact all of us, have got problems. We've all got problems. There's none of us perfect. And those of us who tend to think we're perfect, all right, are the ones in greatest problem. And I want to acknowledge Harry and say that he wasn't perfect. Right, and I'm not going to come along and criticize him, but of course there was one characteristic he had that some people would regard as un-American. And a severe character defect. He had a beard. All right. I, of course, note that there are one or two who have beards around here. And like Harry, I think having a beard is a very good idea. And I'm very glad to know that Jerry also thought that his having a beard was a good idea. But I think that when we look at things, we need to say that there's right and wrong, I think. But we shouldn't be going around saying that we've got it all right. That actually each of us, and especially if we think that we've got it right, those of us who tend to be the most moralistic are probably the ones who are in greatest danger. That seems to me what, listening to some of the things that Jesus said, he found that the people who had a high opinion of themselves were often in trouble. And there we go. So, Henry Cloud suggests that integrity is a lot to do with character. And he says that it's not a book written with a particular religious slant, but he suggests that integrity of character affects your day-to-day work and affects results. And he's been a psychologist who's worked with chief executives of large companies, including some pharmaceutical ones. And he has this wonderful thing that says, we don't think that the way to more profits is a shift in our own character makeup. If we do, we often don't know where to begin. And he looks at a series of six things, and I'm going to talk just briefly about three of them. That if you are to be a person of integrity, you will create and maintain trust. You'll connect with what others think and feel. And he talks about the wake that a ship leaves, and that if it's being steered properly, you see this wonderful wake. You look back, and you can look back, and you see it's a great wake. And I look back on Harry Gesser's life, and I see a great wake. All right. Not perfect, but a pretty good wake, all right? And there are some who you feel don't have a great wake. And the people who have a good wake, you kind of see people surfing on it, the students surfing on the wake left behind. But with others, you feel as though they're merely shark bait. Okay, they've been so disturbed by the passage of someone through their lives. And that happens, and that's not so good. So that creating and maintaining trust, I think, is important. You've got to be able to see and face reality. Reality is always your friend. He tells a wonderful story of the company that was making dog food. And it had a new chief executive who was really dynamic. He really knew how to sell. He had these wonderful sales campaigns, and they didn't sell any of the dog food. And after several years, somebody finally said to him, "Don't you realize, sir, the dogs don't like it?" Right. You can have wonderful sales campaigns, but if the dogs don't like it, you won't in the end sell a lot more dog food. And being able to see and face reality is important. And embrace negative realities. And I think that's part of valuing ourselves for what we are and not what we do. And when you're a student, this can be very difficult. I've had to deal with a few students who we've had to say, no, your work is not up to scratch. But that's your work. It's not that you're not up to scratch. That bit of work is not up to scratch. And you do that when you're doing peer review. All right? But you shouldn't then say, I am valueless because I didn't do something well. I've made so many mistakes, all right, and I've learnt from a few of them, all right, and that makes it a little bit better. So I think that seeing negative realities is really quite important, and that enables us to then get into the problems that are around and move on. So where are the pressure points where integrity is relevant? Well, everywhere. Okay, the areas of research, all right, and we're going to talk about planning, design and protocol, and data collection and data selection and analysis and reporting and interpretation and communication, because those, I think, are the phases I see of doing research. It can be trials, it can be pharmacoepidemiology. And the last two, I think, are very important in regard to integrity, but time really won't permit me to say very much about them. So, planning, design, and protocol. I was got promoted and eventually became professor of medical statistics at the London Hospital. And I used to do a lot of consulting with medics who came in, all right. There's obviously the odd person who comes in and says, I want a pee. And you can say it's down the road, no. And you know, you try and dissuade them from just wanting pee values. But I would distinguish between the scientists and the politicians. The scientists wanted to find out if something or other. And the politicians wanted to prove that or show that something. And I wanted to work with the scientists and not the politicians. And that was not particularly, it was very little of that, was in drugs at first. And you found that there were some people who were very good doctors, but they didn't have the thought of a scientist. They wanted to prove their theories right. And when we come to the planning, design, and protocol, we, I think, should be thinking about the questions. And the integrity we need to have, I think, is that we should focus on relevant problems. And I think the pharmaceutical industry has got to ensure that it does that. That it looks at problems that are important to people. It doesn't invent new diseases that, in order to use their treatments to treat non-diseases. The choice of the outcomes and comparators, the specific comparator, the type and the doses. When I worked at the London Hospital as a statistician, I ignored dose all the time. All right, we did meta-analyses, we put all the things together and so on. And when I went to the medicines agency, it wasn't till I went there, really, even though I'd worked with clinical pharmacologists all the time, I hadn't in my own brain got into my head how important dose was. And when we end up choosing comparisons in trials particularly, doses are really important. Trials are usually well pre-specified in that respect. But meta-analysis and pharmacoepidemiology, I think, seems to be even less well specified very often than meta-analysis. The next area, a pressure point there, where you've got to show your integrity. Data collection, the design of the questionnaires. How many of you have ever heard of Yes Minister? Ah, there's a little group of kind of European-oriented people. Yes Minister is a fantastic program, and also some books about the elevation to power of a fairly incompetent politician dealing with a very smooth civil servant in the UK. And this incompetent politician becomes prime minister. But at some point, the politician says that, oh, well, they did a survey and it showed so-and-so. And the civil servant then asks him a series of questions to which he comes up with the answer, yes, definitely. And then he asks him another series of questions and he finally ends up with the question and he answers, no, definitely. And he suddenly realizes that the last of those questions was the same one. Have I lost the, oh yes, we lose the, there we go. You're quite right. Let's try, there we go, how's that? So our questionnaires can get the answer we want. And you need to be very careful that you have thought of your questionnaire and you haven't had that civil servant's attitude towards designing it. The choice of the database. There's sometimes it's possible to choose databases knowing that you will get an answer that has a certain characteristic. Verification of diagnoses, medications, prescription dispensing and taking medicine are all different. And our databases very rarely, and we're having some discussion this morning over the fact that we don't often have both the prescribing and the dispensing. and in databases, we will never have virtually whether a patient took the medicine. Certainly, you will only know that in some circumstances. In clinical trials, who should do the data management? And I'm going to come to some remarks about the record trial and data management. Data selection. I think there's a very nice paper from Perio et al. With Patrick Waller and Saad Shakir, who show in pharmacoepidemiology and drug safety that pharmacoepidemiology studies have enormous differences between investigators in the exclusion criteria they use. And I don't think that paper has been studied enough. Do you have it as part of your PhD program to study that paper? All right. I think it's really worthwhile, because to realize that different investigators have different views as to who you include and exclude in studies is very important. Now, there are technical issues there, but there's also issues of integrity. Have you thought about it carefully enough? The FDA audits of trials are pretty rigorous. Some of you from the pharmaceutical industry will know just how difficult the FDA can be when they do an audit. They very rarely audit pharmacoepi studies. They do. How many of you have had an FDA audit of a pharmacoepi study? Not one. Oh, you have, just about, through I3. I3 had one, I think. You've probably had the edges of one, have you? Or proper one? Really, it can be very interesting to have such an audit. Frank de Vries and Thierd van Staal looked at statins and fractures, because there'd been two papers, again, something for the students to really learn about. I hope you have read that one, where they found different answers, contradictory answers, and perhaps last year Ken talked about that sort of area. But different designs of studies on the same database can come up with different answers. The analysis, that's another pressure point. Statistical analysis plans are usually well-defined and not nearly as well-defined for pharmacoepidemiology studies as trials. Sunday's advanced topics course at the ISPE mid-year meeting has got Sean Hennessy talking on directed acyclic graphs. And I would argue that you need to do that kind of thinking at the very least, if not using DAGs, for assessing confounding at the beginning of a study. And that then will affect how you do the analysis. And I think that's a really important area. JAMA, with their things, claims that industry statisticians do biased analysis. But in their most recent editorial, which we'll come to, they say they don't want to question the integrity of industry statisticians. But there is no evidence for the assertion that industry statisticians do biased analysis that I can know of at all, none whatsoever. I think in reporting, that's obviously a major area of integrity issues. I would argue that we should be using things like the Strobe guidelines. The consort guidelines have been shown to improve things in randomized trials. And those of you who do trials and those of you who do pharmacoepidemiology should be aware of what goes on in trials. I would argue that every trialist should do epidemiology, and every pharmacoepidemiologist should do at least one trial. I think you should understand both. And Harry was one who was obviously involved in both. But the Consort 2010 guidelines have just been updated and just published in the last couple of weeks in the Annals of Internal Medicine and the BMJ and elsewhere. And when you're reporting, I think you need to have honest assessment of the strength of the evidence. And that is a major area for integrity. We all tend to defend our own theories and ideas rather than look for their weaknesses. And my view is, coming from a particle physics background, that in medicine we aren't nearly as good at attacking what we have done. And the presentation of the data can be to exaggerate the effect, whether that's by industry or academics. From all the years I used to referee around 50 papers a year for the British Medical Journal, and in addition, be going 10 times a year, perhaps basically once a month, to the hanging committee, at which at each one of those we would see about 10 to 12 papers. And what was interesting to me, that the major problem I saw was that the evidence when the paper came in was up here. And we managed to tone it down through the referees' reports and the editors' comments and so on, and we got it down to here, and that's where it was published. But when they then did a press release, it's up here, and then when you found the charismatic surgeon who was at the press conference on the paper, the evidence was way above where it had first started in the paper. And it's a really serious problem, and we don't have it documented. And I think we have a serious problem of the fact that we exaggerate things in our reports above the data, and then when it comes to press releases, that's so. I'm in danger of causing offence. Was the Vigor trial report misconduct? I think it was very close to that. The reporting of the adverse effects, swapping the reference group for the adverse effect on MI, reported a relative risk of 0.2. It made naproxen, no longer the comparator, the drug of interest, all right, and said it had a reduction. Now, the interesting thing to me is I used this very slide in Harvard with Jeffrey Drazen, the chief editor of the New England Journal of Medicine, sitting in the front row, and Kathy DeAngelis, the chief editor of JAMA, also sitting in the front row, and the Harvard statisticians, who are the main statistical reviewers. And I said that with their fuss about that trial, I think this was more serious than many of the other things they did. And the statistical referees should have picked it up. They shouldn't have allowed it. The editors and the statisticians failed with that trial, and there's been no apology from any of them for that. And I was ready to be critical. I said, of course, however, I've done all that refereeing from the BMJ, and I could have made the same mistake, may well have done. I might not have done. In fact, as soon as it appeared, I was critical of it from a very early point, and I've got some slides that date back to a month after the paper was published in which I drew attention to that. But you see, we can't go around blaming everybody else when we sometimes make the mistakes ourselves. And I, as a statistician, I've certainly made mistakes refereeing, I've made mistakes in publishing, but I hope I'm prepared to put my hand up on what I regard as, I think, the authors of that paper distorted the results for the general population. And although what they said was not untrue, to swap the reference group in the middle of a paper can give a different message, and I think clinicians who weren't switched on didn't notice that. But the editors should have picked it up. That's what the editors and referees should have done. And when they failed to, instead of making big fusses about other things, they should have said, we made mistakes as well. And that's where perhaps moat and planks in the eye are things that are relevant. Conflicts of interest, everyone has them, especially academics. Right, and I think I can have conflicts of interest in these things. They can affect the way we analyze or present the data. And particularly with analysis of the data, my experience is that industry have, particularly in trials, have pre-specified analysis plans and detailed protocols. And that's probably also more true, in my judgment, of industry pharmacoepidemiology studies than it is of academic ones. Academic ones don't always do that. They believe in trust, they believe that they are people of integrity, and they don't need them. And it's only the dreadful industry who lack the integrity and have got the FDA breathing down the necks that need them. And that's not true. We all need them. We all need them. So problems that are possibly caused by a lack of integrity. There is evidence that pharma industry-funded studies have more favorable results than others. It's incontrovertible evidence. But they may be looking at different questions. And so when you look at industry-funded trials, they very often have got phase one trials, phase two trials, enormous understanding of the clinical pharmacology and the basic pharmacology of what's going on. And so you bet on them getting a positive result. Whereas the questions that some others do, non-industry funded trials, may not have the same basis. And of course, they may not get the positive results. And I think the serious problems with industry are that there is publication bias, and interpretation of the results is much more serious. The evidence that it's due to a misanalysis, I think, is sparse, if not non-existent. Selective reporting of outcomes occurs everywhere. Chan and Doug Altman have shown that. And the evidence that academic authorship inclusion reduces the problem is, again, very sparse. Ridker and Torres have suggested that. I think the best comparison is by Owls, Nielsen and co. And what they did was that they looked at Cochrane systematic reviews, where there were a large number of trials, and where industry trials and non-industry trials looked at exactly the same question. Because then you've got a valid comparison. And when they're looking at the same comparison, and they found that the industry reported adverse events more clearly, and their overall scoring for the reporting was better for the industry. But, and the results weren't different. The results weren't different. The idea that industry is pervasively distorting the results is not true in terms of the actual results. But the recommendations, yes, that's where there's a problem. They will put a positive spin on their findings. They're not the only ones who do that, but they tend to do that. But obviously it doesn't address publication bias and the fact that industry, as with others, don't necessarily publish the negative ones. Access to protocols via ethics committees or IRBs is very difficult. And although in Europe we have a directive on clinical trials that requires protocols for industry and non-industry funded trials, I don't think it would help that, because we're not necessarily getting access to protocols. And again, in the BMJA, there's a rather sorry story of the fact that people were denied access to protocols, and that is true for industry and non-industry trials. There's possibly outcome reporting bias greater in joint industry government funding than in government funding alone, and there is evidence there. Now, when we did our own study of comparing trial protocols with published reports, we did this in The Lancet, because The Lancet, if you are prepared to submit your protocol for a trial, and as it happens, in principle, an observational study as well, to them, they make a commitment to say, we will referee your protocol. And if the methods are good, we will give you nearly 100%, but not quite 100% guarantee that we will publish your trial, whatever its results. Long ago, I was involved in a trial, and we framed for a while the letter from the journal editor, who said, we really like your paper, your trial is absolutely excellent, but it is not going to be published in our journal because the results are not statistically significant. That was actually the words used by the editor. And the Lancet acknowledged that publication bias is a problem. And so there are a whole load of protocols registered with the Lancet. Right? And then the papers get submitted to them. Not all the papers appeared in The Lancet, but some of them appeared in other journals. And so we were able to look at 37 pairs of trials and protocols. And there was a change in the primary outcome in 11 out of 37 of them by the time it appeared in print. I found that absolutely staggering. 32 of them had unreported or new secondary outcomes. Absolutely staggering. And the selective reporting and misuse of subgroups, really major problems. The interesting thing was, of course, we had a really nice paper at The Lancet, and The Lancet turned it down. It was obviously critical, effectively, of their refereeing process, because the protocols are available to the referees. And they let us publish a letter, which is very difficult to find it in PubMed and so on. And it's a letter there. But these trials are nearly all non-industry. And so the idea that this problem of integrity is focused only on industry is simply not true. I don't know whether any of you have seen this issue of bias in meta-analysis published in PLOS. Anyone had seen this, noticed it? Yeah. There you are, you've learnt about one new paper at least coming to my lecture if you're still away. Kirkham and Doug Altman and Paula Williamson looked at 288 protocol and review pairings. So we've got the Cochrane review, not of trials now, but of meta-analyses, systematic reviews. And there, in order to do a Cochrane review, you have to, in principle, provide a protocol and then do the review. And the protocol is up for free comment within the Cochrane collaboration. And 64 of these, 22%, were discrepant in at least one, if not more, of the outcome measures that they were saying they were going to look at. And 75% of those 64 were attributable to changes in the primary outcome of the meta-analysis. And this is happening in the Cochrane collaboration. And everyone says the Cochrane collaboration, the Cochrane reviews are the gold standard and industry reviews aren't nearly as good as that. I'm afraid it's a problem all over the place. And they've had this wonderful sentence where lead authors could recall a reason for the discrepancy. Isn't that lovely? Potential bias in 29%, with changes being made after knowledge of the results from individual trials. Okay. Now, I think that's a serious problem, and it's something that we're not really doing well at, to be honest, and we've got to admit that there are problems. Outright fraud, fabrication and falsification is an area I've been particularly interested in because I got caught. Not me, personally. I hadn't fabricated things, but I was caught because one of my co-clinical investigators fabricated data. Right, and we withdrew two Lancet papers, and there's a paper entitled Reanalysis of Data in Two Lancet Papers, and I could give you the history of that and tell you about fraud if you want. I have a minor reputation in truth, really, Jenny, in pharmacoepidemiology, but I shall be immodest at this point and say I have a major reputation in fraud, or at least the detection of it. And regulatory scrutiny, I think, is really helpful, and I've been involved in some of the things there. I think that the way that regulators look for detecting fraud has some adverse effects. And outright fraud, which I've known about in a number of instances, much better dealt with by industry than academia. The dean of our medical school, when we first detected this fraud and the guy had admitted it, he said, "Do you have to say anything?" All right. He was the late Sir John Ellis. All right. Now, he very rapidly was persuaded that we did have to say something, and we then published and retracted the paper. We didn't say it was fraud. We had a letter from all of us authors who were uninvolved, plus a letter from one person who admitted total responsibility for the errors in the data. And he said, and his lawyers said, "You can publish that, saying errors, rather than that it was fabrication and falsification of data." But that was what we best did, and that was in the late 70s, early 80s. But my experience in lots of other places is that the academics want to hide the fraud to protect the reputation of their institution, at least as much as the industry does. And in fraud, the industry doesn't want to hide that at all. I know of no instance where I can demonstrate that the industry has hidden it. They have nearly always come out and very clearly said what it is. The fact that they've involved me might be so. I think that all data should be able to be given to journal editors. Now, that's something that's quite controversial, and we'll talk about that. The evidence that outright fraud is a problem in epidemiology is very limited. I know of only one serious case of epidemiological fraud, and that was Sudbo in Norway. How many of you know of that case? Only one of you. That's interesting. He was a guy who produced with co-authors, analyses of data purporting to come from databases in Norway involving oral cancer. And some of his work led to trials of treatments of combinations of COX-2 inhibitors and non-steroidal anti-inflammatories for oral cancer. It was quite staggering, all right. And he involved his wife, he involved others, and as far as one can tell, it was only he who knew what was going on, that it was only he who was doing the fraud. And I think whether that is really true or not, I don't know, but he had various individual issues. But I think that the evidence, and Anders Ekblom carried out the investigation, and he's known to a number of people here, and you should probably talk to him about it. Now, let me say a few words about JAMA's reanalysis policy. It applies to pharmacoepidemiology as well as trials. They say that studies will not be published by JAMA that are conducted only by statisticians employed by the company. Independent analysis must be conducted by statisticians at an academic institution, and the entire raw data set should be given to the statistician, and that's what they've said. And I think the consequence of that say that academic statisticians act as technical analysts after the study has been designed and carried out. And I don't think that's the right role for academic statisticians in studies at all. And they justified it by citing the Wall Street Journal. And Kathy DeAngelis, who I really respect in very many ways, but I disagree with her strongly on this, says that they were burned very badly on the, and said in public that they were lied, she was lied to three times over the data on Celebrex. And I think it's very, very unlikely that she was directly lied to. I think that the question that she asked was probably answered truthfully. But I suspect that somebody might not have been telling her everything that there was, but the questions she asked, she got the answers that were truthful on that. A famous secretary to the UK cabinet in an Australian case had that wonderful phrase, said, was asked if he'd lied. He'd said, no, but we were economical with the truth. That's not integrity, really, is it? So I think trust is linked to integrity, and I think that legislation and guidelines and policies don't obtain that integrity. I think I'm a believer in guidelines, but we can't pretend that that gets it. So I have some problems with JAMA's solution to this. Academics who analyze trials for industry may not be really independent. How do you know whether an academic is truly independent? And I have to say, as a personal thing, I perhaps should be very careful, given who I'm a disciple of, in forming judgments. But there are some academic statisticians who I think are entirely independent and others who are not. And I come across some people who appear in front of the regulatory authorities who argue more vociferously on a company's side than anybody in the company. And probably some people in companies have found people doing that as well. Now, they may have those beliefs truly as themselves, but I think the idea that academics are de facto independent is not true. The data management, I think, is much more important, but that's not required. And industry suppression of unfavorable trials is not addressed, and I think that is a very much more serious problem. And I think there are a number of problems with the JAMA policy. I won't go through all the details of it, but you will have seen perhaps in JAMA, March 24th, 31st, the Easter issue of JAMA, an article by Steve Nissen, and I'm sorry, the bit that says cited to unblind there, I'm no good at cutting out bits from PDFs and removing them. I need to have better students around me to make prettier slides, but there we go. And the article by Steve Nissen about this that related to the Congress's investigation and Kathy and Phil's editorial, it was very interesting that they have the word integrity in the thing. And the title of this talk was set long before March the 24th, even for me, who does things at the last minute. And I think that the really big issues have not been addressed here, because I think that the paradigm of diabetes and heart disease being associated with glucose control seems to be wrong. Everyone says diabetics have disorders of glucose metabolism, diabetics have high rates of heart disease, ergo, glucose metabolism causes heart disease. Well, it may well not be true, and people have believed that, and there's still argument about it. And there's a very, I think, in the same issue of JAMA, which is not referred to at all by Kathy, I think it's a shame, really. There's an editorial by Mitka that discusses those very issues. There's a GPRD study by Curry from Wales, not a known pharmacoepidemiologist, who, because of the findings, has suggested that both low and high values of HbA1c, glycosylated hemoglobin, are associated with high levels of heart disease. And the ACCORD trial showed that really reducing your blood sugar in that trial led to increases in mortality and increases in MI. And I think that a lot of fuss around the Nissen meta-analysis is an issue of relatively small harm, but the real elephant in the room is the lack of benefit. Because everyone assumed that if we got really good blood sugar control, we would improve heart disease. And it didn't happen, and it doesn't seem to happen. And we don't fully know why. Because, of course, diabetes, I'm only a statistician, but diabetes is also a disorder of lipid metabolism. Right? It doesn't only involve that. And edema seems to be a class effect of the glycosones. And it seems to me that you won't easily get benefit on the heart if you have something that is causing notable edema. Whether that's true congestive heart failure or not, I don't know. Some of my pathologically oriented friends have said that the sort of lesions you get in diabetics in terms of their heart is not the same as you get in non-diabetics. And I don't think people have done nearly enough work in that. Anyway, what are our solutions? Should we study, put our PEPI, pharmacoepi studies registered with a publication of the protocol and data analysis plans? ISPE has been considering that issue, and I think it's an important one, and I think that's a step forward, but it isn't that simple. I think that regulators should be able to comment on published studies. Certainly people in the FDA and people in the UK Medicines Agency know that things that have been submitted to the regulatory authorities are quite different to the things that appear in the press. And usually that is not the doing entirely of the company. The academic people want to publish their own bit and put their own thing, and the companies perhaps don't prevent them from doing that. But I think there should be able to be something of that kind. There was a recent meeting, I don't know how secret it was, of major journal editors. Anyone know about that meeting in Washington a couple of weeks ago on this business of availability of data to journals? And I think they're moving towards doing that. So what should we be doing? What should you be doing as students? Valuing yourselves for what you are, not just what you do. And I think the profession of being a pharmacoepidemiologist is worthwhile. I think that we should adhere to professional values, and ISPE has done something along those lines. The Royal Statistical Society's code of conduct is much more clear in that way. I think that if you're in a company, you've got to face negative realities about analyses or products. And I think it's possible to have integrity in whatever situation you're working. And the idea that you can only have integrity if you're an academic and not if you're working in industry, I would want to stand up against. And I think that is quite wrong. I don't carry a flag for the pharmaceutical industry, as you'll know from some of the things that I've said. But the idea that anybody working there doesn't have integrity is just simply not true, and it's really upsetting. I think we should perhaps in pharmacoepidemiology think a bit more about the possibility of fraud sometimes. I don't know. I think it's really exciting as pharmacoepidemiology. Having come from particle physics, I think our intellectual challenges are enormous. I think its multidisciplinary nature is really interesting. And I would encourage people to do clinical work. And that helps you and those of us who don't do clinical work to not forget the patients. We don't live in isolation, and the patients at the end there are the ones with whom we have responsibilities. We need wisdom, not just knowledge. We need to see the big picture, standing back and saying, what's really going on here? We need integrity and not just regulation. We need creativity and not just productivity. So Harry, I think, modeled integrity as far as I can tell. I have no reason to think that. He worked for industry and for academia. I think he was the same person, as far as I could judge, and that seems to be from everything people have said, in both situations. He didn't change like Jekyll and Hyde from one employer to another. And he valued patients and students, and they were the people for whom he was there. Let us who are academics remember that we're there for our students. Let those of us who work in the health professions remember that we're there for our patients. Thank you very much.
We have time for some questions.
I wouldn't want you to keep you from the reception too long, but I'm happy to answer questions. And I'm glad there was a bit of applause because it wakes up those who are asleep.
Thank you for your presentation. You said you knew a very few outright fraud in epidemiology. I seem to remember there was a large breast cancer treatment trial, a multi-center trial in the US and Canada, where two centers, I think they were in Canada, were found to have been fabricating data. Are you aware of that?
Yes. That wasn't pharmacoepidemiology. That was a trial. But it wasn't epidemiology in what it wasn't observational studies. I should have said what I was meaning there was observational studies. Observational studies, we know of very few outright frauds. But trials, we know of loads. I can tell you, of at least 20 that I know of through personal experience. That was the Roger Poisson case. And there the fraud was a very odd one. It was that he altered the ages of people to ensure that they got into the trial rather than altering the outcome values. And there's some very interesting thing that's published in the Journal of Controlled Clinical Trials, Richard Pito and others, and I have made comments on that trial. And it was very emotive because it was breast cancer, but it was not inventing outcome data. It was including people who shouldn't have been included and altering their ages in order to do that. And he didn't invent people. Hugh at the back and then Kevin.
Professor Evans, hello. I'm Hugh Tilson, a friend for many years of Harry Guest. I rise to thank you for your kind and gentle words about Harry. Many of us who knew loved him felt moved by your comments, but even more by your actions. He was a master of understatement and dry wit. So are you. So great to have you give this talk. You didn't mention something that is quite precious for academics, and particularly for students to learn, and that is their role as peer reviewers. Could you talk a little bit about integrity among peers as peer reviewers?
Yes, I'd like to do that. The interesting thing is that I've probably been involved in more of the randomized trials of different ways of doing peer review than nearly anyone. And I think that peer review, I'm convinced, should, if possible, be more open than it is. BMJ requires peer reviewers to sign their reviews. They also instituted a yellow card system for that. That is an adverse reaction thing. For you to be able to tell the BMJ editor of adverse effects that you had as a result of signing your reviews. And certainly on one occasion I had someone at a party come up to me and say, you reviewed my paper, and he was a big man and he put me in a corner and he shouted at me at this cocktail party, and I found it very unpleasant. And I didn't hit him, and I didn't do anything, and I said I was just on the hanging committee. I didn't. You know, it was the peer reviewers who rubbished your paper, and we tended to agree. But I think that peer review is a whole other topic, and I could do that. One of the things that I think was wrong was an academic who sent the Nissen paper to GSK, faxed it to them, and GSK then did the interim analysis of the record trial. I think that saying that it was totally wrong to do the interim analysis, given the Nissen meta-analysis, is a difficult one. As a regulator, I was very glad they'd done that. It gave me useful insight. I was pleased. But the peer reviewer should never have faxed it to the company. And if the company had had their brains engaged, they'd have said, we're not going to do anything, and sent it back to the peer reviewer. And they were set into a panic. But I think that as peer reviewers, what you have to do is that you have to try and say, any of my actions, would I be very happy if other people did those same things to me? And I hope when I'm critical without being rude. I try and be truthful, but I also have to say that I may be wrong. And peer review, I think, is a very, very poor system, but it's the best we've got. Okay, I'd love to talk some more about it and give you data on all those things, but the fundamental thing of saying, if I'm reviewing something, let me just, and it goes back to Henry Cloud's views of reality, connecting with other people's reality, okay? Connect with the investigator's reality when you do it, and say, let me reread this peer review as if I were the investigator. Do I behave with this in a way that, am I going to steal the ideas? As it happens, can I tell an anecdote? You're all right. When I give my talks on peer review, I live in Hastings, and how many of you have heard of Piltdown Man? Lots of you have heard of Piltdown Man. He was a famous fraud perpetrated in Piltdown in East Sussex, near where I live. And so if I go and talk to the local Rotary Club, they like to hear about fraud because it sounds interesting. And I talk about Piltdown Man. And I'm one of the few people in the world who think that the curator of the Hastings Museum was the one where, and I live in Hastings, was the one who perpetrated this fraud. And the reason, one of the reasons I think is that after he died, they had to throw away a large number of the specimens that were claimed to have been collected around Hastings, but were demonstrated to have been bought as birds, rare birds, in Italy. All right, and he claimed he'd found them around Hastings. They also found in his desk drawer the manuscript of a book sent to him for peer review. What they then found, of course, was that he'd published it under his own name. So it's not new. But if you're doing something of peer review, stealing somebody's ideas from that, you shouldn't do. So, sorry, I've gone on.
The word you depend on is that sort of sort of like a oxymoron when you, with the JAMA, because you're going to be, because you're going to be behaving as a statistician to review, but that not be disclosed in the acknowledgement.
Oh, absolutely. Well, I think that's a very point that Ken Rothman and I made in our response to the JAMA on that. But it's very interesting how many people, if you go and look at the citations of our paper, you find that when Ken Rothman and I attacked the JAMA policy, the people who commented on it say that Rothman and Evans don't wish to have increased scrutiny of pharmaceutical industry things, and they are there defending the industry. We weren't defending the industry at all. We were just saying that policy was not logical on that among other grounds.